Moses has now spent 40 years in the wilderness. Okay? 40 years in the back of the beyond, he's been there. And God actually draws his attention. He sees this bush that is burning, but it's not burnt up. Right? And so he comes closer, takes a look, and God has a conversation, dialogue with him. And in short, God is saying, listen, I heard the cries of my people in Egypt. They were slaves in Egypt. Right? I've heard their cry, and I'm coming down now in response to their cry. And basically, God invites Moses into an adventure. He says, now I want you to go and take my message and bring my people out. Okay? But Moses was not so sure that he's the right person. Now, 40 years before that, he was very sure that he was a person. Right? He was confident, he was young, and he was, you know, and he was going to do it. He was going to make it happen. And we know the story how he kind of messed up and killed a guy and then was challenged about it, and then he ran for his life because he knew he'll be killed. Anyway, fast forward the story, 40 years, he's in the wilderness, right? And so now when God is inviting him to bring the people of Israel out, to get them out of Egypt, he's lost all his confidence. I was thinking about it the other day. Maybe the first couple of months, he was afraid and he was wondering, is anybody coming to get me? And then after that, he knows no one's coming and finding him in the back of this place in the wilderness. And then months pass and years pass, and then he's married to this shepherd lady, shepherdess, and has some children. And he's just so used to being there and just counting sheep and just, whatever, go out in the morning with the sheep and come back in the evening and watch over the horizon, the sun is setting, and maybe he remembered Egypt sometimes, maybe he remembered his family, I don't know. But we know that 40 years is a pretty long time. So all of his confidence is broken right now, right? And he's not sure. So what happens is, in this, when God invites him to come, I want you to go, I'll send you, I want you to go and get the people out, he's not so sure. And so he's asking all these questions. He's making these excuses. So from chapter 3 onwards, you can read that and see. And let's go over to the next. Yeah. So he makes some excuses. The first two you'll find in chapter 3. First he says to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh? Who am I, right? And what do I tell? So, God answers these questions. That's not what we're going to look at today. But he says, what should I tell them your name is if they ask me? And then God says, tell them I am that I am. And God gives him all these explanations and he's patient with him. And then we start off in chapter 4, verse 1, with the question that we want to look at today when God says, what is in your hand? All right? But God says this or asks this question to Moses in response to a question that Moses asked. So let's go over to the next slide. Exodus chapter 4, verses 1 to 5. We'll just read it, okay? So Moses has already asked these two questions, right? Who am I? What if they don't believe me? And now it's continuing. Exodus 4, verses 1 to 5. Moses answered, what if they do not believe me or listen to me and say, the Lord did not appear to you? Then the Lord said to him, what is that in your hand? A staff, he replied. The Lord said, throw it on the ground. Moses threw it on the ground, and it became a snake, and he ran from it. Then the Lord said to him, reach out your hand and take it by the tail. So Moses reached out and took hold of the snake, and it turned back into a staff in his hand. This, said the Lord, is so that they may believe that the Lord, the God of their fathers, the God of Abraham and Isaac and the God of Jacob, has appeared to you. So Moses' question was, what if they do not believe? Right? So 80-year-old guy, right? He had given up on all his hopes. We know he was a hopeful, zealous young man because, he took it upon himself and he killed the other guy, the Egyptian who was messing with the Israelite and all of that background story. Now he's 80 years old. He's lost all hope. He's watched many sunsets come and sunrises and sunsets. Now he's 80, he's settled. His dreams are over, right? That's what he's thinking. That's his reality, okay? He probably remembered his past failures, right? And specifically where he took things in his own hand and he killed this guy. And so the past failure now has become a present reality of discouragement. Right? His previous disappointment has become, or his past disappointment has become his present discouragement. Because he's going by his experience. He says, oh, I tried and it didn't work. I had to run for my life. So this is where he's at. But there's also a key thing I want you to see. Because see, God was telling him, listen, Moses, I'm going to send you. And he was answering all these questions. What if they don't believe me? What if this and what if that? And God was answering, I'll be with you. So if you read actually chapter 3, I believe it is in verse 18, God had said, listen, those people, the elders of Israel, will believe you. You go. I'll go with you. My presence will be with you. And those elders, when you show them, when you talk to them, and you do, you know, you and your brother Aaron, you can convince them, they will believe you. He had a clear word. But he was so discouraged at that point, or is he had no hope at that point, that even when he had a direct word from the Lord, from the blazing fire in the bush, God saying, you know, they are going to believe you, so go. He says, his question was, what if they don't believe me? Isn't that interesting? So to that question, what if they don't believe me, is what God is answering, what is, you know, with another question saying, what is in your hand? So I wanted to keep that in mind. In fact, actually, the last verse, maybe it's verse 30, 31 of Exodus chapter 4, actually says that when he went and said it, they did believe him. But see, he was gripped with a fear because of his past failure. His past failure or his inability to have accomplished a task which he thought he was doing. God had called him to do this and he was doing it and it didn't work out. It was a total flop. Right? But that failure was so strong that in the present reality, God comes to him, appears to him and speaks a clear word saying, they will believe you. Go, I'm going with you. And he was like, but what if they don't believe me? Right? And God is now asking that question. Okay? Valid question. I understand where you're at. Let's see what's in your hand. All Moses had was what? A shepherd's rod. That's all. I should say he had a stick and a stutter. You remember he used to stutter, right? So for 40 years, he had been using this rod. This was like his constant companion, right? And so now God is asking, what is this in your hand? This rod, which he had been using for 40 years, now God was going to teach him to do something else with the same rod that he had, right? So that simple rod, a shepherd's rod, later becomes a sign of God's power, right? We'll come back to this though. Moses not only delivered an entire nation with that rod, you know, the simple rod, he just had a stick, right? But all of the miracles that he did was connected to that rod, the parting of the Red Sea and the Amalekites when they came, the rod, you know, and the water out of the rock. All of that had come from that simple thing. When in that place of discouragement, in that place of feeling less than nothing, of feeling that he doesn't mount up to anything, he can't do it, God asked him, what is it in your hand? And he had said, this is all I have, a staff. And so I just want to give you a quick picture of what that little staff that he thought was nothing, what that accomplished through God's power. All right, let's go over. So God's question to us today is, what is it that you have in your hand? Right? No matter how insignificant it may be. And see, this doesn't necessarily mean it's something in your hand. What do you possess? What do you carry? What do you have? Right? And see, I wanna maybe back up a little bit. For Moses, when God asked, what do you have? He didn't say, well, I have a staff. He was just, excuse me, can't you see? I don't have anything. This old staff. He probably even just said a staff, almost thinking that this is to be overlooked. But maybe he was just cynical. Maybe he was like, duh, can't you see? This is all I have, like a stick, right? But whatever it is, however small, however insignificant that we may think it is in comparison to a lot of things, God's question is, what is it that you have? Right? Because God has always used small things, insignificant things, unnamed people, no-name prophets, right? The small things to do great work. And example, a few examples are, if you, I think it's in Judges 15, chapter 15, where Samson, the strong man, right? One time he was cornered by the Philistines. And it says he turned around and looked, he didn't find anything, no axe, no sword, no big things. He just found the jawbone of a donkey. And it says he took the jawbone of a donkey and he slew 1,000 Philistines. I don't know how he did it, but, you know, but it was whatever he had. Samson could have thought, man, I don't have anything. What can a jawbone of a donkey do? But he used whatever he had. And God, it was not even the strength of a jawbone. I'm sure if we try to take a jawbone and do something, it was the Spirit of God that had come upon him. And so when the Spirit of God comes upon the person and the Spirit of God wants to do something through the person, there has to be something. And so that jawbone ended up in history. We know the story of David with his 5 smooth stones and a little sling and I think he had a bag and a staff, right? And Goliath was laughing and mocking at him. Right? You come to me with a stick and a stone. This is what Goliath, if you read in 1 Samuel chapter 17, right? I think it's like verses 30 to 40, you'll find Goliath was laughing. Are you coming at me? Like, am I a dog? You're coming at me with a stick and a stone? But that's all David had. He had tried on the armor of Saul, or Saul had made him try it on. And David was like, no, this doesn't work for me. What I have and who I am is what I'm going to do. And so he goes with that 5 stone, just something insignificant. He didn't even need the 5 stones. He just needed one, right? And then there's this interesting story in 2 Kings, chapter 4. This is a widow whose husband was a prophet, and he had died, unfortunately left them in a lot of debt, and those days they would carry the sons away if they haven't paid the debt to be slaves. So she comes to Elisha and says, My sons are being taken away as slaves. Can you help? And so the prophet asked her a question. What do you have in your house? Go home and read that chapter. So you have to understand, they've scraped the bottom already. They have nothing. And so now the debtors are coming to take away her sons to work as slaves to make up for the money that was borrowed. And so she didn't have anything. She says, well, I only have a little bit of oil in my house. See, some of us may not even think of saying that. Because we think, I have nothing. Like, it's interesting because I sometimes hear people say, I have nothing. I'm like, and I look at them and I think, you have an education, you have a good smile, you have energy, you have strength, you have time, you live in one of the best countries in the world, you have friends. You know, there's so many. Sometimes we don't see it in that place of discouragement and despair. We don't see it. But anyway, the widow says, I have a little bit of oil. And the prophet says, okay, let's work it. And then he says, go gather all the utensils, all the, you know, bowls from the other houses and bring. And she brings it. Bring whatever, gather whatever you can, and you can keep pouring the oil. And you know, it's a story, it's a fascinating story. She pours the little oil that she had, she pours into all these containers, and they all get filled up. Go get more. And so she tries to get everybody's containers into her home, just borrowing. Just give me for 2 hours, I just need a container. So she keeps pouring, the oil comes, and then the prophet said, now go sell all that you have, all the oil. Right? So, but the point is, what did she have? She says, and when the prophet asked her, what do you have? She said, I have a little bit of oil. And so throughout the Bible, you'll see, you know, even the widow that fed Elijah, right? I find it interesting. She was on her way to commit suicide. And then God's encountering her right there and says, okay, the last bread, you have that? Okay, the last piece of last meal? Let's see. Get this done. So throughout, and then we know in the New Testament, in John chapter 6, where Jesus feeds the 5,000. It says a little boy had 5 loaves and 2 fish. The boy's name is not even mentioned. That little kid, right, made history. But it was the little that he had. What is it that you have? So the question comes back to, what is it that you have that God is asking? Because, see, our question is, what if they don't believe? This is in the context of us doing God's will. In that particular case, it was God's will for Moses to go back to Egypt and, you know, say this and confront Pharaoh and bring the people out. Whatever it is that God has called us to do, right? Our question may be, but how can I do it? But I don't think I have what it takes, right? But God's question is, what do you have? What is it that you have? And we need to sit and ponder about that question. Let's go over to the next slide. So I found it interesting that God used something that Moses had already been using for the last 40 years, right? And so when God calls a person to follow him, to obey him, or to do something, to minister, or whatever it is God calls someone to obey, or to follow, or to do something new, do something spectacular, do something insignificant, whatever it is, and God gives us a leading or a call to do something, often we think we are not equipped, but God has already started the equipping way before. You know, when you were little and you didn't have enough and you had to learn how to share, that experience will come in use, right? When you were in school and you didn't know how to speak in front of an audience and you got special training and they forced you into it, and that will be used. When you went, you know, to live with grandma in this part of town and you learned a new language, and God is going to use that 30 years later. Whatever it is, God is already preparing. See, the process of preparation starts way back because God knows the end from the beginning. And so we think that in our despair and in our hopelessness, we think that, okay, now you're calling me, now I don't have anything. How do I do this, right? So the interesting thing is, when God calls, often he doesn't need something new. He doesn't need us to start up with something new. Most often, he'll start using what we already have, what he has already been working on, what he has already built into us, what he has already given us the experiences, and that'll be part. Because we wait for something new. Okay, so now you want me to do this. Okay, and then we compare ourselves with all of the other people who are good at that, or who've done that for 20 years, and we gauge, you know, success in our own natural eyes, and we miss the whole point that God is not looking for all that. What you need, God has already started building within you. He has already put within you. He just wants us to give it to him. He just wants us to know that, you know, hey, you have it, whatever it is. You know, sometimes, let me go this further. Sometimes it could be our own weakness. I have nothing, Lord, but my weak self. Okay, bring it to me. I can do something with it. It's not just about what is in your hand, but it's about surrendering what is in our hand. Right? Obviously, that's understood. But because Moses was able to throw that down, I'm glad he didn't say, this is the only thing I have for the last 40 years. No. And to a degree, when God asks us, what is it that you have? He's not just saying, hey, listen, you have something. He was saying, if you surrender it to me, I can make something out of it. You know, because it's not in the power of that very thing, right? What Moses had was just a simple stick. There was no magic in the stick itself. The stick itself was not supernatural. It was the man who carried the stick who had surrendered it to the Lord. So the power was in the surrender. The power was in aligning with the will of God. The power was in saying, yes, I'm ready, even if it doesn't make sense to me. So the power, the real power of the miracle, or all of the stuff that happened, and the power was in the surrendering of what it is that I have. Even when you feel it's not significant enough, right? In his hand, it was a shepherd's rod, but as he flowed with God, in God's hand, it became a rod of power. A rod of heaven. See, the staff represented some things in Moses' life, okay? In the last 40 years, it represented who he was, his identity as a shepherd, right? It symbolized his income, because keep in mind he was a shepherd. So the number of sheep mattered, that's the wealth, right? The livestock. And it also symbolized his influence. Now, you may tend to, you know, smile at the influence that he had. He had some influence over some sheep, come on. If he used that rod and said, hey, over here, they had to come. Or he could whack one of them with this, or he could just get. So, his identity, his income, and his influence all was represented by this rod. All right? So when God was saying, okay, throw it down, you'll see this rod, this was a dead branch, dead beat up branch used for so many years. This dead thing comes alive. Right? And then when it picks it up, it's dead again. Right? So in a parallel, in a way, if you see, whatever, whether it's our identity, whether it's our income, whether it's our influence, whether it's our title, whether it's our possessions, whatever it is that we kind of carry, we, you know, that's ours. And God is saying, what is it that you have? Can you lay it down? When we don't lay it down, it's still dead in us. It'll still be a dead stick. But when we lay that down, then it becomes a live thing. Now God can work with it. But when you take it back again, it's mine. It becomes dead in our hands again. So the whole idea of surrender is not just, okay, I have $200 and I just surrender this to God. That it's more than that. You know, if I back up, that's why I said, let's stay here for a minute. If I back up, this was not the first time that Moses had to rethink about who he was. See, we know Moses grew up as a prince of Egypt, right? He was brought up by Pharaoh's daughter in Pharaoh's palace, right? So 40 years of his life, he was like, I'm the prince of Egypt, you know? And he also knew, because his mother used to nurse him and has somehow told him, he knew who his real identity was as an Israelite. He knew he was not an Egyptian. So that's why he tried to defend the Israelites, because he knew that they were his people. He knew somewhere in his heart, or obviously told by his mom, his real mom, he would have known that God has ordained him to be the redeemer, to be the one who will bring the people out. He knew that. That's why he was trying it in his own strength. Also keep in mind, I think it's in Acts chapter 7, verse 22, says that Moses was educated in all the wisdom of Egypt, and he was powerful in speech and in action. Now, we know Moses as the one who stutters, right? So he had an identity, he had an influence, he had a power, he had a certain dignity, and so that was who he was before, the prince of Egypt, powerful in speech, right? And he had all the wisdom. And mind you, Egypt was one of those most flourishing civilizations at that time. So he was educated in the palace, and he was well equipped. And you'll find that in Acts 7:22, that he knew it all. But then he had broken everything about his confidence and his identity. It was all gone. He was not a prince anymore. He was, one who was powerful in speech. By the time he was in the wilderness for 40 years, he says, can I really do this? He was so nervous about it, because he used to go to Pharaoh and say, let my people go. Why couldn't God use him when he could go and stand and say, let my people go? With all the eloquence and the power and the ability and the confidence. See, God had to break that down too. He had to make this person depend on him. And whatever it was that was, but all I'm trying to say is that the second time round, he gave up that first identity and the first influence and all of that. He became a broken man. 40 years in the wilderness. Now, just when he's comfortable with just being nobody, God comes and says, even the little that you have now, can you surrender that? Now I want you to go. I don't know if you've ever felt like that. When you felt that you were already and
good to go, the opportunity doesn't come. We talked about it, didn't we? Royce and I had talked about it. When we thought that we were ready for ministry and all that, it didn't come. Nothing happened. And failure after failure, we messed up and all that stuff. So many things happened. And then when you're broken and you realize that you need God, and then you're just in, you know, that place, then God says, okay, now I can use you. Now you feel, I can do it. Okay, good, now I can use you. So his second time, his identity was, my shepherd, I'm just a shepherd. I can't even speak. I'm slow of speech. But God was saying, whatever it is now, you put it down, I can breathe life into that. Your identity, your income, your influence, whatever it is that you're holding on to, your title maybe, you know, your dreams, your hopes, what you, your hands have earned, your, you know, hard-earned income, whatever it is that you have, if you can lay it down, if you can surrender it, now I can use it and I can change a nation with it. I can do miracles with it. I can confront the pharaohs of the world with this. I can do things that has never been done before. This will be for the glory of God if we can learn how to surrender whatever it is that we have, whatever it is that we have to God. He can breathe life into it. Hallelujah. You know, let me tell you something. This happens multiple times in a person's life. Every time it's a fresh dedication. Every time it's a fresh surrender. Every time it's a newer revelation and we surrender again. It's like giving our lives over and over and over again to the Lord. So let the Holy Spirit convict you today. That whatever it is that you have laid down, God can breathe life into it. God can make it something completely different. And His glory will be seen through that.